Okay, we are here with Olivier. How do you say your name, Olivier, or how do you say
Yeah, Olivier. That's
Olivier
great. Absolutely.
from EchOpen the EchOpen project, and we're discussing a few good things about collaboration, open source product development. What are some of the best practices we can share on in terms of moving the open source movement forward? That's a big question we talk about a lot. And for OSE itself, we started as basically talking about open source ecology as a new paradigm for an economy that's ecologically sound, provides good lives to people, and follows the open source principles. And so one relevant thing is I'm actually looking at starting I'm planning on starting a podcast so that it's just voice, but so this is not part of the podcast, but I will do that because there's a lot of really good content about with a focus on here's how we actually tackle real pressing world issues. So basically asking the hard questions that are worth talking about. And I feel that kind of an approach is missing today. Like nobody's really linking, like in the high level discussions, linking open source as a central theme towards how do you get to the better society. So that's why I want to do that. And just one more piece of background on this. On our work is our focus is on the concept of distributive enterprise. So that's the idea that we publish our designs, not only the designs but also up to the production model where we do large group massive parallel builds as a viable way to produce products, kind of like the micro factory scenario where you get together with a bunch of people and create a bunch of product in a single day, which we call extreme manufacturing, which we've done, like for example, for the brick press, for the power cube, or the house. The house is a little longer. We build the house, the latest house, we build that in 5 days, but it's a big swarm process. Like for the house, it was 60 people can build a house in 5 days. It was a 140 square meter house, and things like that. But using that model as a viable way to produce things in the next economy. So we believe the next economy is the open source economy. It's like the next $1 trillion economy. But that's what we do. And right now we're inviting people to collaborate on developing the distributed enterprise. The first one. So far we really had nothing that from our work that went viral. We had about two dozen replications of our work around the world in about 10 countries or so. But it's far from having a significant impact on creating right livelihoods for people or changing people's lives in on a much broader scale. So we're focusing that down, taking first the 3D printer as a thing that we can produce in workshops, and then moving on to other things like the torch table, like the heavy machines, the houses that we promote openly as people replicating them actually to make a living with them, and starting with the 3D printer. So that's where we are. And the discussion here about the acoustics, that's with respect to the height sensor on a CNC torch table, which is a powerful machine for cutting out all the metal for our heavy machines. But that's where we're interested in open source ultrasound sensor as a height controller for the CNC torch table. Possibly even for other things like the 3D printer, because we like to reduce the number of total parts. So that's what we're interested in. So that's kind of the background of where we are.
Okay. Well, but the ultrasound technology that you're planning on using, the best would be absolutely to discuss with some of our experts in the community, in the EchOpen community, because we need today more focus on using this technology for a medical purpose, as we're using ultrasound technology. Well, actually, if I can give you like a little overview of the project, that would be something interesting. So the project first started, well, the idea raised late 2014, so something like 2 years ago. So we start like having discussion with some friends and people in the academic research laboratories. And sorry, I have my phone ringing all the time. I just turn it off. Hold on, excuse me. This is off. And so we started the idea late 2014. Then we gathered people and and saying, okay, let's try to use technology that are in the public domain, that are aged like dated back to the 80s. And we said, okay, today we have much more powerful components, electronic components. We have a smartphone in our pocket, which is a supercalculator compared to the 30, 40 years ago. And why can't we use this old technology of ultrasound imaging applied in healthcare and update it with this new component in those new machines to make a universal eco-stethoscope? What we call an eco-stethoscope is a universal tool for to help medical doctors in doing the diagnosis. Like, you are a doctor during the medical consultation, examination with your patient, and you suspect something, so you just take your probe, you connect to your smartphone, tablet, or any computer, and you can see what's inside the body. Because the idea is, a medical doctor, for since Hippocrates, they have their five senses to diagnose a patient. Then 200 years ago, Leinek invented the stethoscope. So the medical doctor were able to listen the heart, lung, and more or less, and this is more or less what they can do with a stethoscope. But now we have had the idea to give them a tool to not only hear the heart beating, but also seeing its beating. And following this, you can also see any organ inside the body. So that's more or less the idea. But today, ultrasound machines are very expensive. So we want to develop it in an open source way. And also we want, because you said doing stuff, making tools, doing objects, but it's also doing, like, it's also creating a common knowledge that we can share, and using this collective intelligence to tackle some issues, some technical issues, medical issues, legal issues, because we have to take a lot of legal issues, actually, to design issues, usability issues. Well, it's a long list of issues we have to tackle one after another. And that's also the reason why we decided to build this with a community. So we first raised a little community, and step by step, the community is now like gathering more or less 300 people around the world, so which is pretty interesting, as they all have skills, knowledge linked to the project. So it's more or less the way we developed this. So the idea was late 2014, and we had our first prototype last March. So the first prototype that can display an image of an anatomical part of the body. And then we mobilized the community to improve the quality of the image, to reach medical standard, I will say, to reach a much better quality to fit with the needs of the medical doctors. So it's more or less what we did, and today we have a we're about to have the new version of the prototype. Actually, we create our prototype in a very specific way, because we made a kit out of the prototype. So it's some modules. So we split the device into several modules, and each module represents more or less a few skills that people have. So you have the analog electronic part, the digital electronic part, you have the mechanical part, the sensor, that is a piezoelectric element, the mobile app, and so on, and the acquisition chain, and so on. So we split it into modules, so we design an object that now anyone can build, I will say. And if you go on our GitHub, you will find the last generation of the probe, of the prototype, and anyone is able now to build it. So we're pretty proud that today we have some of our kids in South America, in Africa, in different places in Europe, in France, in universities, in hackerspace, in a lot of different places, and have people working on a specific module. So each module is documented, so you have all the files, the source files needed to build it by yourself, and also all the information needed to know what should get in at the signal and what should get out, and what's the range, what the standard that should get in and get out. So you can just remove a module, try to improve the module, put your module, and just compare with the benchmark of our the prototype, and or you can replace two modules by one. You can like play with that, like it's in a pedagogical way. I mean, and that's more or less the way we develop the hardware side. The software is more like following the open source principles, and we have community, and it's on Git, and people develop some parts and then send it by pull request, and we merge after a review. So it's more or less the way we're working, and step by step we meet people that bring people and bring new people, and it's very circular. We have a lot of people, so we're pretty lucky being based at Hotel du Hospital in Paris. So we're just in front of Notre Dame, which is actually very central and very easy for us, because we are supported by the APHP, which is a public organization gathering almost all the hospitals in around Paris, inside and outside Paris, and they supported the project and they decided to give us a space in this hospital, because it's very central, and this hospital had a little space for us, and then we have the community that can come 24/7. So that's pretty cool to make things happen, and also some people working remotely, and so that's more or less the way we are executing this. And now our next step will be to find a way to miniaturize the prototype, to make it like a real tool, and to find a way to put tool in dock. The reason why we decided to launch tool, because 2/3 of the world population, according to the World Health Organization, do not have access to diagnostic imaging. So it's more or less 5 billion people around the world. So it's a very big issue, and it's what we want to face. Because today, if you want to buy a ultrasound machine, it's between, I will say, 8,000 for second hand, third hand one, or ultra portable one, until hundreds of thousands. So our idea is to make sure that healthcare professionals around the world can have in their hand a tool that is cheaper than a smartphone.
How much is the transducer?
That's an interesting story, because a transducer could be between a few hundred depends on the transducer you're looking for, but it's between, I will say, 150 and 800, depends on the quality, the frequency, and so on. But we also develop a research program with the ENS Cachan, which is a research lab, and with them we made our own transducer. I mean, we had this piezoelectric element, uh-huh, and the backing, so we developed our own backing, and we made it for less than $50.
Okay.
Considering that we paid for very specific, well, actually we bought the piezoelectric in France, which is more expensive than if we buy like 9,000 in somewhere else in the world. So this is the most expensive part of our transducer, but we can find very much cheaper piezoelectric elements. And so that's also a way to turn on the community and trying to hack this really proprietary technology and release it in an open way.
Can I ask you this? The way it works, just for my knowledge, so you can see inside, for example, you can image a baby inside a womb. So the idea is that you have a reflection, say, from the skin, then you have a reflection from another layer of the body, and so forth, and you see
absolutely
that as a function of time?
You send a pulse, an electric pulse, to the transducer. So so you excite the piezo element, and then it's vibrating, and then it sends a ultrasound, and ultrasound goes through the different tissue, the different organs, and then it comes back, and the transducer plays the role after like it's like a speaker and a microphone in the same element.
Yeah.
So it will send the sound, receive the sound, and then you have all the acquisition chain that will like look for the that will calculate the difference between the signal out and the signal in, and they will translate it into an image with a gray level scale. You see what I mean?
With a what?
A gray level, gray scale of gray.
Mm-hmm,
it's
mm-hmm.
not black and white. It's a scale of a different level of gray. So that's the way you make the organ appear. So considering that today with a very high quality, very expensive ultrasound machine, you can't see a baby with in its mom's. Body with a lot of details. Our point is not having the same kind of details. It's really to help the medical doctor to orient the diagnosis, not to have a very, very detailed information, and just having the most important information. And according to the emergency physicians we're working with, they consider, even in the northern countries and southern countries, that we can decrease by 50% the number of people waiting at the emergency room. So that's more or less the impact in terms of waiting time, in terms of emergency, because sometimes you have to wait, and it's a matter of life or death. So this is one advantage of what we're doing. Then it's also render accessible diagnostic imaging everywhere in the world, even if you are very far in the middle of nowhere, we'll say. So you can have access to this image. It's also for the follow-up of pregnancy, because per year you have 8,000 women dying from pregnancy complication, and so that is something we can tackle, not 100%, but in a very important way. What else? And for the healthcare system, it's also decrease expenses, because when you go to the doctor, you use the stethoscope, you try to find out what's wrong with the patient. So you try to find a diagnostic, and sometimes you need some complementary examination. But when you send the patient to complementary examination, it's more cost, it's more time, it's more medical time too. So if you can have just a probe in your smartphone, put the probe on the patient's body and realize that the problem is this or this, and have your diagnosis. You don't need this, so you win time, money. You save time, money, and also you can at the end save life. So that's more or less that's our philosophy. Well, that's the idea of the project. So
yeah.
It's an open source project, but it's also a medical concept that we named Eco Stethoscope. So like a mix between sonography and stethoscopy. So it's a way to mix, just to make people think that tomorrow we make it, doctors will have in their pocket a probe, in the other pocket a smartphone, and wherever they are, they will be able to have a new tool for diagnostic and have a very, very quick image. So that is what we're doing. So that's the reason why also we split the project into 9 different matters, including the medico-technical matters, which is like the one very important to develop the objects. And then we have other matters such as community management, communication, public health, ethics, because we also have some working group inside the community working on ethics and the relationship between the using the probe, the usability, and the patient. We have economical matters in terms of public health, but also how to finance the resources you give to the community to make it happen. We have, you can see on the website, on the EchOpen website, all the big, the a big topic we're working on. So we split it into sub-projects and with different groups with specific skills. And it's the way we organize this. And most of our documentation is used to be on a wiki, actually, but we switched to use GitHub, like a Git system, with a markdown document, which is pretty easy for anyone to contribute. And so we have source files, we have documents, we have more or less everything. And step by step, we switched from the wiki, which is like full of information written by many, many people, to a more structured documentation and information for a larger public.
Are you full-time on this?
Not exactly. We have a part-time on this. We have one person full-time. He's he's a PhD in acoustic. So he used to be a researcher and is full-time on this. So more is coordinating all the technical aspects with the community. And then I'm like a little more than half-time. And with Maddie also was part-time too. And then it's the community, but with various level of engagement. Some people give like hours, days per week. Some others just sometimes. It's a real mix between availabilities of each people.
How is the person funded?
Sorry?
How is the person funded?
What do you mean by the person, like the project? How we're funded?
No, like you're saying, a person is working full time. How are they funded to do that?
Oh yeah, we received funds from a foundation, which is the Foundation Pierre Fabre, which is a French foundation based in the south of France, mm-hmm. And they provided some funding to pay for the components, the equipment, this salary of this. We have only one people within the project by this money, and then we also provide all the resources. I mean, so it's an association, it's a non-profit, so as a legal structure, it's a non-profit organization, like Association Web des Nations, that's the exact name in French, and so we raise some little funds to pay those resources and
uh-huh. What's your budget right now?
Well, it's a budget, I will say. I don't have the last, as we are at the end of the year, I just sent all the documents for the accounting. I would say we spend 100,000, 130,000.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good. So I'm looking at the picture on the page ecopen.org, the daughter boards,
yeah.
Configuration. So you have that's what you built at present. Like, what's the best build? So you have actually had a couple of people replicate?
When you go on when you are on the website, you go on the documentation, you click on documentation, and you have a picture. And this is actually,
yeah.
This is not the last. This is the one before a version of the prototype, but this is the kit actually. So with the app on the smartphone, you can have an image from like anatomical part of the body. So you can see we are using, so on the, this is the it's a 3D printed structure with the mechanics inside.
Mm-hmm.
You have the transducer with the little black round element on the right with the, there's a motor inside to make it turn.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have all those electronic system with this modules I was talking about earlier. That's the reason why it looks this way, because anyone can like remove a module and put his own module made on a breadboard or whatever. So we decided to have a motherboard down the all those modules with 19 different signal on it. So it's structured this way. And then we're using at the moment the TGC, and so those three cords. So two are now removed, by something we made by ourselves, and we still use the Red Pitaya you see on the right, which is an open source board that have like a lot of there is an oscilloscope inside, FPGA, microcontroller, what else? Mm-hmm. We have a lot of different components inside, so it's pretty useful for this. And on the other side, we build another kit.
Can you share your screen and
open lab?
Can you share your screen and point to some of the parts?
How do I share?
Go to the left and it's the green button.
The green button.
If you scroll to the left, there's a green button there, screen share.
So, here it is. Oops. Okay, share.
Yeah.
See it?
Yeah.
So this is the mechanical part. Mm-hmm. This is here the transducer.
Yep.
Here's the acquisition system with all the electronics. Those two cards we removed by making our own system that we add in this empty space in the motherboard you see here. Here we're using this white PTIR, which is an open source board with a lot of different elements. And the point is, today we have this whole kit connected, I will say, more or less all the time in our open lab to with a phantom, what we call phantom, inside some water. So we can generate image for the signal processing team with online platform, and they receive image, they develop a algorithm, and they test it on the platform, and there is a leaderboard that will give the best results according to the phantom, because when you have phantom, so you have an element inside a box, and all the elements are documented, so the server know the response, the right response, like what it is and where, what's the size and stuff like that, and people try with algorithm and improve the algorithm for the signal processing, and we compare with the information from the phantom. So we have a leaderboard, and the best results are the one can take a part of each algorithm and make its own algorithm and try it on the system. So that's the way it works. It's soon going to be released. Now we're using it internally, I mean, with the signal processing group in the community, just to fine-tune some very small elements to make it publicly accessible to anyone who wants to contribute to the signal processing. Then, so if I go down this way, so you will see all those DB is daughter board, MDL is module, so you have different module and daughter board. So daughter board are kind of module here, you see, the daughter mm-hmm. board just to split into. This is a configuration, so that's the V2.1, so we will then release the V2.2 or the V3, probably the V3. You will find here all the function. So you have the function corresponding like sensing, emitting, receiving, sweeping, processing. The interface between two modules. The configuration is this one, for example, the sweeping probe, so the one we were on. All the modules, when you click here, you have the list of the module with the pictures on it here. And the daughter board, which are kind of module, and various devices. And usually when you click on the GitHub link, you find the details about the considering module. So if I come back here and I go to the pulsar, for example, so I'll find the pulsar here. So with all the information directly, because it's automated documentation. So we have a script that will go explore all our repository on GitHub and publish automatically the documentation online. And if you go to the corresponding GitHub, you find all the same. I will say the first the same information and also all the source files. So
do you use wavelet pulses as well?
Sorry?
Do you use wavelets as well?
What is wavelet?
A finite
Sorry.
Sine wave with an envelope. Okay, no, signal processing details. I did that in my PhD.
Oh.
But anyway.
No, this
bad
is
memories.
And you have all the source files here. Here, and then you can navigate inside the GitHub.
Yeah.
Here.
Okay.
The way you want. So this is embed system, this is signal processing, this is kit. So each So project has its own repository, and we use the EchOpen starter kit, which is here, and you have all the content here, but it's automatically published on Gitbook, which is another tool we're using for the documentation. Like more for a guide and guidelines and this kind of documentation to make people understand what we are doing, how we are doing it. So this is a document that is always on ongoing. I can show you because this is pretty useful and like three kit book for the moment. So this is the starter kit, just to give you an idea. So you have the introduction here. This is the main topic, the nine topic I was talking earlier. Different topic we're working on with the community to in an inclusive manner. So we have very, very different kind of people with different backgrounds, with different skills coming all together and trying to tackle those challenges. And when you click on read, you have all the documentation, how to integrate, how to warm up, the Facebook group, all the way you can consider. So we now, like, soon will be released the acoustic basis, like to make anyone understand the basics of acoustic. If you want to set up your own lab, like the way we did it, you have all the pictures, all the documentation about the hardware, so you have all the technical introduction, all the functions, so that's the environment from the user, the sensing, well, everything is documented here by many, many people, with every interesting part of the, like, all the theory is here. And,
how do I get to the Gitbook? From GitHub?
The Gitbook?
Yeah.
Well, actually, when you are on the EchOpen website, and you build hard, for example, you have the starter kit here, the source file, documentation, and soon we probably will connect the Q&A. Same for the software side. Starter kit is the same. The source file, the documentation, which is very specific. It's another Gitbook, actually, that you can access here. It was playing with data, so you have all the code, what you should have, and so on. So all the mockups we developed, the different version of the mobile app is here. And we finished the integration with the hackathon based in both Paris and Morocco, and some people in Canada, working all together. Just before Christmas.
If I finish let me navigate to the Gitbooks, ecopen.org. Where do I go from there?
From ecopen.org, you find, or you go to build soft here, or build hard, and the startup
build with us
will lead you to the right Gitbook, or you go to gitbook.io. gitbook.com/@ecopen.
Okay, hold on a second. Let's navigate from the site. From the site, ecopen.org, where do I go?
Build soft or build hard.
So this is under... How do I get to the build soft, build hard page?
You just, from the main page, you scroll down.
Okay, build soft, yeah, okay.
You join us, you have all the way to get like expression of interest. I want to get involved. I want to discover your agenda. The Slack-in is out right now, so we are setting up. We are resetting up.
Okay, I see.
Help us because we have also options to get support, to provide some, to let people providing us some equipment, to open their facilities, because we are working. Part of the development are made in research labs that open the door to the community, schools, other hackerspace, makerspace in different places in Europe and around the world today. For the moment, we don't have press, whatever. You can have a little bit about how we made it, the way we work, some of our support, visiting, and the wiki, but unfortunately the wiki, a part of the wiki is in English, but most of the information inside the wiki that we used before, we don't really use anymore. We're using now the GitHub and all the automatic documentation system, but you will find a lot of information about like transducers. If you look up transducer, you will find a lot of Open Foundation, like transition model, open transition. You will find all what we developed. It's fully documented. Transition models. So if you're interested in transition, you will have like all these documents that you can load also from here. A lot of articles, because we made a review of the literature. You can find like all resources, interesting resources like that CIMUT, for example, so kind of transistor. So you will find everything on the wiki. But a lot of information are in French, this wiki.
Yeah.
We translated. We have people in the community who translated it into English. Not all, not everything, but a lot of. Session, you will find all the challenge we learned about scan conversion. So everything is here documented. It's a little messy, but with the research tool, you can find more. You can find what you're looking for.
So you're working with 1 microsecond pulses, and is that the resolution of the transducer, or you can get much better resolution than? One microsecond would be the pulse, but you can probably get resolution of that like on a much smaller scale, or no? I'm trying to see the resolution that you can get, like for example for ultrasound height sensing.
Well, yeah. The resolution of I know the resolution of the image, but the resolution of the transducer, that would be better for you to discuss with Jerome, because is it is a field of research, so it's more relevant than I will be discussing mm-hmm. about like
yeah.
detail of the transistor. But just for us, the idea for us is using three different frequencies. So we want to put three transducers in the probe
mm-hmm.
That's turning 3.5 megahertz, 5 and 7.5 megahertz to have different, to get in different depth in inside the body.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. What's the cost of the current system that people can build?
You mean the kit?
Yeah.
You mean the kit that I showed you before?
Mm-hmm.
It's actually, this is actually pretty cheap. The last people who did one, they spend $500 for the whole kit to get. Well, actually, we can ship for people who are really interested. We can ship some PCB, empty, actually PCB. You just have to buy. We have somewhere in the documentation, you will find the list of the components that you can buy and put on the different PCB. This is 3D printed. The motor is like a few euro or dollars, which is expensive as the Red Pitaya, but like $200. And the transducer, depend on what transducer you want to use. This one we use here on the pictures costs 600 euro. But
mm-hmm.
we have also some company we know that sells very cheaper transducer. Or what we do pretty often is we go on eBay, we buy old ultrasound probe for $20 and we
mm-hmm.
take the transducer out of it. Usually it's not working only, but the transducer is still working. So for $20-$25 the transducer.
Mm. Yeah.
What we do, we go on eBay, probe, broken probe, we get it. Or we go to a hospital and say, do you have old broken probes? They have to be single element probes, like old probe. If it's a phased array or new probe, this like phased array probe, it's not possible to use it. But if you find like old probe, you have 1,000 probes like that on eBay, just get one and for $20-$25 you get one. So for about like 500-600, you have the old kit,
yeah.
which is expensive, which is more expensive than what we plan on having at the end because
mm-hmm.
of some cards.
Yeah.
The way it's made, like it's made to be made by hand, not needed a machine to be miniaturized for the moment, to let anyone being able to contribute.
When's your next prototype build?
The next prototype, so the next version of our prototype will be probably finished by the end of this month. We're just finishing some benchmark with sonographs, like regular big sonograph. So we're doing the benchmark and we fine-tuned some elements to have both sides, like to have medical image quality, because we want to reach the medical standards to be useful for a medical doctor to help them to orient their diagnosis.
Would the price be higher on that one, or it's also the same?
It probably be around the same and probably a bit cheaper.
Currently it works by plugging that into a cell phone or just the microcontroller? Right now you're using the microcontroller, right?
We use both, actually. A part of we have different groups working on different technology. We have people working with FPGA, with DSP, with microcontrollers. So we try different technologies to process the signal. A part is made inside the probe, by the system inside the probe, and a part is made by the smartphone, especially to receive the data. It's for the moment it's wireless, due to the Wi-Fi protocol transfer. So the data arrives in the smartphone through Wi-Fi, and the phone display the image. The idea is to find the right activity for the right device, because it shouldn't be too it shouldn't need too much energy to be able to use it as long as it's possible, using the smartphone and the probe. It shouldn't be like it shouldn't die after like 2 minutes. So that's the idea.
You started the project?
Sorry?
Did you started the project? You're the founder?
Not alone. We're four co-founders.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm one of them. Absolutely.
Yeah. What's your background? Are you into medical imaging?
I have. Absolutely not. I have a background in fundamental science at a university. Then I studied economics. After that, I worked in the industry, especially mostly for international company. And then I moved to Southeast Asia for 8 years of humanitarian development, Southeast Asia. So that's more this part that I'm bringing on the project, because we will be able, with a tool like this, to address the huge issue that I faced during the first time I spent in Southeast Asia. And actually, when I was there, I launched some development projects support victims of violence, mostly women victims of violence, trafficking, and prostitution. And we did it in a community way, actually. So we built a program, a social medical program with those women, those victims, and it's and also with researchers from around the world, and all together. So it was like fully inclusive, and it was so we worked all together to find out how we can address their issue. And the good point is that we get great results in the reinsertion rate of those victims in the society. So that was pretty cool. And when I came back to France after this project that I co-founded either, actually, I realized that community-based approach is very relevant to tackle issues like global issues like those. So that also something that I put inside this project.
And what'd you go to school for? What'd you get do in school?
Excuse me, what I did in school.
Mm-hmm. School. What did you study?
Like, science, like mathematics.
Science.
Chemistry.
Mm-hmm. What motivated you to start this project or be on a...
Many things. something big and very affordable. And we can, like, with collective intelligence, we can tackle technological, medical, and so on issues and challenges. So that's the first point. And then the, I will say, the human situation, that two-thirds of the world population do not have access to medical imaging from diagnostics.
And how do you see that in Southeast Asia? The hospitals didn't have it?
Just a few, but you have not enough. You don't have enough hospitals, healthcare professional, you don't have enough health worker to support the patient over there. A lot of people die because they arrive at the hospital too late, because it was too far, because they don't have access to tools, they don't have access to medical doctors, they don't have access to whatever, because of the price, because of the distance, because of the training, because of the quality of the roads, so because of many factors. So with this, we can imagine having, because you already have doctors in this, very far in the countryside, that are turning around, like, they go visiting villages one after another during the week. So with this tool, we can imagine having something very fast, very close to get to that, and anticipate a real health problem.
Was there a personal experience that drove you to this need?
Yes, absolutely.
What was that?
And also because we met one of the co-founders, which is Pierre Boyer, is a radiologist at Saint-Louis Hospital in Paris, and actually had the idea a few years ago of this concept of eco-stethoscopy. So when we met all together, we realized that we have all the complementary profiles and skills to start something. So we said, okay, let's go. And the first idea was to gather people in our network, like friends, and I will say friends as family, people we know, gather all together and say, okay, we want to do that. What do you think of it? And they say, that's cool, I'm in. So we said, okay, go for it. Let's go. It's a very nice adventure.
Can you put me in touch with somebody who can help on the ultrasound height sensor?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. That will be cool for you to have a discussion with Jérôme. I'm not with him right now, but if you are available, let's see, probably, if you're available at the same time, Monday,
okay,
that will be perfect. It will be here, and then, so you have a talk with him, and according to your specific needs, we can also ask people in the community, if he cannot answer some question, we can also ask other people in the community.
He's one of the co-founders?
No, he's the only employee we have.
Okay, so he's a good guy to talk to.
Yeah.
Mhm. Yeah.
And he got great skills.
Excellent. And what's the profile of most of your contributors? Is it a lot of people in the medical field, or that's a smaller part?
Let's see. We have various profiles, from students to researchers, like very high level researchers. One third of the community are healthcare professional, more medical doctors, young and not young. I mean, like, very different type of experience.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have engineers.
So it's a mix of all kinds.
I can say it's one third as healthcare professional, with people in the health industry, the healthcare industry, medical doctors with different specialties, and but the rest is very, very heterogeneous, with engineers, researchers, technical technical people.
And so you're pushing, tell me, okay, step back, you're pushing the open source license quite a bit, so you're radically open source, or you're strong about that? You're not going to pull a MakerBot or anything?
No, we try to advocate a lot on open source in the healthcare industry, which is not easy every day.
Do you have a lot of resistance from your contributors?
Sorry?
Do you have resistance from contributors? Some people aren't okay with open source?
All the contributors are okay with open source in the community. They all know it's for our license, all the software part is BSD3,
mm-hmm.
and all the hardware part is the EchOpen license, which is a GPL license actually, but we just removed the reference to software to have to be more focused on hardware. So it's a GPL for the hardware and a BSD3 for the software.
Yeah, very good.
The content, it's CC by SA, it's Creative Commons.
Okay. And what's, do you recruit people actively, or people just come?
We recruit actively. Try to organize a lot of events, a mm-hmm. lot of workshops.
Yes.
We try to speak about the project. This is the only communication we're doing. We mm-hmm. speak about the project in schools, in academic research laboratory, in mm-hmm. scientific event. So we just speak about the project, meet people, and they get involved.
How do you manage the community? Is it do you have working teams and meetings?
Yeah, we have every Monday at 7 Paris time. We have weekly meetings.
Mm-hmm.
Then for each working group, have a weekly meeting too for 1 hour. Could be
how many working groups?
At our lab, signal processing, ethics, and patients. Probably 7 at the moment.
7 working groups, and each one has a full team.
The working group is a team. Yeah, it's a full team with usually we like having couples. I mean, having someone who's have a great experience, but not a lot of time, and some others like students or young professionals
that good.
Have less experience but more time.
So you have at least 2 people on a working team.
Each working group it's usually between I would say the smallest team should be 3-4 people, and the biggest should be like 15.
How many? 50 or 15?
Between 12 and 15.
Between 12 and 15, yeah, that sounds right.
That's the biggest group, it's the signal processing, because it's pretty easy, signal processing, like all the software activity is pretty easy to work remotely when you're far, because everything is just like sharing code.
Mm-hmm.
Some other topic,
So do you have all your four co-founders leading the big Monday meeting?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. How many people do you have on that call? Is that just for the team leads or for everybody?
It's open to anyone.
Mm-hmm.
And it's actually the Monday weekly meetings is open to anyone who's interesting. Anyone can come. But it means that if you're coming to this meeting, you're part of the coordination committee. Like you coordinate the project. So you're part of the coordination.
Wait, is that a physical meeting or a virtual meeting?
It's a physical meeting, but we have Hangout or Skype or whatever open for anyone who want to join from where they are.
And so you hold
when
it at
you are
the...
in this meeting, it means that you coordinate. Hmm?
So the physical meeting is at the hospital that you said?
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, how many people show up to that physically?
Validated period or not, but at least we're 3 or 4, mm-hmm. and sometimes we're 10, 12, 15, depends.
Mm-hmm.
Depends on anyone, and some people just come like one time a month, so it's more on general matters, like, okay, let's do an update on this working group, this, what problem they face, how can we help them, what should we do, like, mm-hmm. we have to organize a general assembly, when should we have this, and, mm-hmm. you know, it's more like general question.
How many days does it take, how much time does it take to build the unit of the echo stethoscope right now?
You mean if you have all the components in front of you?
Yeah.
And you have a little experience? Probably 2 days, 2 or 3 days.
Mm-hmm. And it's mostly assembling
all the code and set up everything and make it up.
And down the road, you're going to do like an more integrated board, or are you going to keep it?
No, we have plan on making things more integrated. Absolutely.
Yeah.
But for the moment, the community needed something to, because we have people came and say, I want I have another idea for the pulsar, I have another idea for this part, I have another, so we split yeah. it into modules to let anyone with new ideas to change
right.
this module or this module. But in the future, when we will have something more stable mm-hmm. in terms of technology, everything on the board, and have something very much smaller, and then because people will work on signal processing, on algorithm, and mm-hmm. all those things.
Yeah.
What's so they will have something integrated, and they will be able to work on it easily.
What is the most one of the things that you found that you're doing well or you're very effective at in your work that we can possibly learn from?
What do you mean exactly?
What did you find? What are some things that really work well in terms of development process? I'm hearing module-based design. That's a powerful concept. We use that as well, correct?
Yeah.
Module-based design is a great one. What else are some things that are really working that you're feeling like you're getting good contributions from people?
Well,
I mean, do you think... Well, first of all, let me back up. Let me back up a little bit and ask,
yeah.
Do you think that because it's an open-source project, you're actually able to do really well compared to another company? Like this crowd intelligence, how many, like at present, what would you say would be the full-time equivalent that you have right now? Or is your velocity visibly better than, say, a private corporation wanted to do this? Or what are your thoughts on that?
That's a good question. I don't know if a private company like the Commonwealth will be better or not. Probably they will do better in a way that they will do it like faster and probably a little faster. But, let me give you two examples. First, we have been working on a form factor for the probe. And we today have developed some ideas of shapes that are pretty unusual in this field. But it has been made by more than 100 medical doctors. So this is something a regular company couldn't do, that's for sure. Then we'll give you another example.
You're saying that the feed you think you developed, because you had so much input from all these different doctors, you got a really good product on that?
Yeah, absolutely. We have many people tested the different shapes of the form factors. We've been working with a lot of designers, so they brought ideas that nobody would have been thinking about, especially medical doctors, but step by step, they realize that we find a specific shape that is for everyone, for all those people who participate to do this. They now mm-hmm. said when they use a regular machine, they use other shape, it doesn't really fit me. And they it's funny to see that when we started to work on the form factor, they said, we cannot imagine a different shape than all those probes that already exist. And now it's different, we have a different shape, and people say, we don't understand why we've been using so long this old shape have, and that exists everywhere. So you see,
so that's crowd intelligence.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll say something else. The other example is like, when we work on denoising the image, removing the noise from the image, we had very interesting insights from people who are very far from the medical area. For example, they're working on astrophysics, and astrophysics, it's also black and white image, and they also have a lot of noise. But they deal with noise very differently than medical engineers. So that's also something interesting to bring from somewhere else, ideas and way of doing similar things, but in another field, and to see how it works. So that's also something very interesting.
And you
only community this way can
so you picked up some techniques from astrophysics.
Yeah, because in the signal processing team, we have researchers in astrophysics, so they come with their idea of signal processing.
Yeah, great. No, that's exactly how it's supposed to work, is that you're supposed to be getting better solutions.
And something that works pretty well, it's having splitted the project into those nine big challenges, and inside those nine big challenges, having set up sub-projects.
Yeah, definitely.
And each a project with the leaders, with a team, with a channel on the chat, on the we use Slack for the moment, but we have a channel on the Slack. Each sub-project have its own channel, its own GitHub repository, but everything is accessible. So it means that you can participate to any project if you want to participate to one, to all, to it's up to anyone. And with regular meetings and dedicated time where people meet physically or online, exactly the way we're talking, just to create some common grounds, something common that when we share experience and we learn to discover one another, that's something that is working pretty well. And also the fact that we have a space. I think that we wouldn't have been able to achieve what we did if we wouldn't have a physical space available for some people to meet sometimes and get access to equipment and stuff. And if I have to express a challenge, we're very happy to have researchers from the academic world who's part of the community, but we would love to have more, and they not always understand their interest in coming into open source community like this, even if they have a lot of interest. For example, when we work with some researchers that also are teachers, and especially in electronics, for example, we'd say, okay, you have a kit, we have our kit, you have all the documentation, so for your workshop with your students, you don't have to prepare anything. So step by step, now we have kits developed in universities, and teachers are using it in a pedagogical way to teach electronics, mechanics and stuff. That's something very interesting, but it wasn't easy at the beginning to convince people to use the kit as a pedagogical tools. But step by step, it's
very nice. Are you planning on doing an explainer video? Do you have any explainer videos?
That would be great, but probably in the future, in the very near future, maybe for the next release of the prototype.
Are the applications? What are all the applications of this? So this is for medical sensing. It's also for height sensing in our system. What other sensing, distance measurements, imaging? What else? Medical imaging. Any other applications?
No, that's more or less.
I mean, what about like 3D imaging of just interior spaces? Does that work?
What do you mean?
Like, for example, 3D scanning using ultrasound. Does that work?
Sorry, it just cuts the sound.
Yeah, 3D scanning. Does that work?
Oh, we interact with researchers that to move an object from one place to another without touching it. So we can also do a lot of things with ultrasound, but yeah, it's really sometimes with energy that it's not really possible to have a system usable out of a research lab, if you see what I mean.
I'm missing the point. First, what was the part?
You're asking of application of ultrasound, right?
Yeah, other applications.
Yeah, we have some researchers that we are interact with. They did clamps with the ultrasound, with no physical object, just using ultrasound as a clamp, taking an object and moving the object to another area on the table, for example.
What kind of object?
A little ball, like a
So just the sound waves moving things. Okay.
Yeah, a little ball. So that's but it needs a lot of power supply.
Yeah. Does that work? Does ultrasound also work for 3D imaging, like interior of a space?
I would say theoretically yes, because if you just like scan all around and you have enough processing, you should be able to reconstruct. It's what the very expensive sonographs do today. You have like 3D, what they call even the 4D image of a baby. See what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And you also use sonograph, like the big one was very expensive and very like to scan the baby, and then they 3D print the baby, like the not yet born baby. You see what I mean?
Okay. Yeah, but what about just for not space inside of an object, but just surfaces like a room?
The ultrasound. The problem is that for inside it's easy because if you're in the air, the signal just like.
It bounces too much. There's too much noise.
But it's very complicated to use it outside of water or liquid because you lose your signal. You see what I mean?
I think so. It scatters too much. Too much scattering. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, kind of. But that's something Jill will be able to tell you precisely.
Okay, no problem. No, that's good. That's good. Okay. So I think we can wrap up here. So what are your thoughts? Any possibilities of collaboration?
With you, probably. I hope. If you have any idea, well, actually, we can what we do, what we can do and what we're doing with other open source projects is, of course, sharing experience, sharing good ideas about how to organize, to sustain, to mobilize, to structure the community, the project, how to advocate on open source, how to tackle some specific issues regarding legal aspect, whatever. So that's everything. That's something we do already. We share a lot with other projects abroad and in France, especially in the medical area, because we are trying also to gather people working in open source hardware devices in the medical area, or medical imaging in an open source way, or open source software in the medical industry, and to try to gather those people just to share what are our specific common due to open source on the side on one hand and to medical on the other hand. So that's something we do. So we are always happy to meet new people and to interact and see how we can like develop things together. And also we, for example, we met some people working with drones, open source drones, but they have to face similar problem as us in the motor. Like they need something very regular, something like some motors very specific, and it's not exactly the same need we have, but it's pretty close. So sometimes we collaborate in trying to find the best way to this part or this part, and it's the same with some electronic, some anyway. So when we have some overlap, I mean, technology overlap, like we're using something very similar, could be interesting to collaborate, just to open the people's mind within the community to other projects, to other use of some specific technology somewhere else. So that's always very, very interesting.
Yeah, definitely. Tell me more about the drone people. Are you collaborating with them?
Yeah, we used to when we needed. When at the time we had some issue with the mechanical part, especially the motor. We had a lot of interaction, and we also spent a few months at our lab working with us on the side as they were working on their project. So that's something we also do. For example, we also have an artist from South Korea who's coming to try to do art on what we are doing. So she's for months now, she's very close to where we are, and she will be based in our space. We also collaborate with schools and academics. So this is not really open source, but people who are really into open source in a research lab or schools, we collaborate more and more to get access to the equipment and to train the students to collaborate a new way. Because working within a community, it's a way of collaboration that is very specific, because you're not working at the same place and not working at the same times, but you're working on the same stuff. So it's something you have to deal with, and this is very interesting to make people's mind be very agile, very smooth, very reactive, being able like to switch from one thing to another and to connect to things. And so that's something very interesting also for people to share with a more, I will say, a more academic environment.
Yeah. Tell me your thoughts on the mass creation of right livelihoods. I mean, that's how I ask these questions with respect. Okay, collaboration on certain projects where we can generate revenue, the revenue model being the extreme production workshop, where you invite people to a workshop to produce things. Right. So that's how I ask these questions. Like, for example, if there's the 3D drone, 3D printed drone or something, or other project that's really open source, does it qualify to be a distributive enterprise, something where we help others produce that? I mean, that's our model of how we try to go along, is to get as many people working with open hardware to distribute that as a means of livelihood. So that's our direction all the times. So like, for example, if you guys develop a really robust product, we can collaborate on production engineering, the open source production engineering, meaning the parallel group process for building that. That's definitely something we can do. And also
that
other...
That would be cool. Yeah, that would be wonderful, because this is a real question we have at the moment. So yeah, now we have a working prototype. We're almost to have this quality of the image needed by the medical doctor. So how we get from this prototype to something in doctor's hands? And that's a real, real, real big question. So that's also a working group we're setting up at the moment with like people who have a big experience, like a very significant experience in this. And so we're trying to gather those people and making them like thinking about what are the models. So then the idea is to set up as much model as we can, like that could be relevant for us according to our like specification. And then to give this information to the community and see how the community, what the community is willing to do in terms of models. But more or less, our idea is finding a way to get this product being industrialized and at the end being sold to the healthcare professional around the world. And the idea is having probably some partnership with some people who are very good at it because it's their job, and sharing the revenue with our organization and their organization, just for us to maintain the tools and the resources for the community to maintain the technology and update technology. So this is more or less what we're thinking.
Yeah, I would suggest building.
That will be something interesting.
Well, I would suggest, my suggestion to you, that what we're doing right now is we're funding our work by workshops, by production workshops. I would suggest that you take that, consider that model, because you don't have to depend on anybody to do that for you. Like, you're not dependent on funding. You're actually building in the revenue generation function into your organization by doing things like workshops. So if you're the master of this...
What do you mean exactly by workshop model?
Okay, workshop model. We run a 3D printer workshop. 12 people build it. they pay a little bit above the bill of materials to take a 3D printer home. So they produce
Okay.
it. Like the numbers are, we got $300 above the bill of materials in our workshop last year. So we made $3,600 for one day. And that's
Okay,
good
cool.
if we can replicate that and think about even doing more people. Like I'm thinking about the auditorium of people, 50 or 100 people, one day. So you set up a big mass production event with people, because the key is that we're training people how to build stuff, not relegate that to sweatshops. You know, I like that model because it makes sense. The community-based production model makes a lot of sense, and I think that's the future of the world. You have microfactories in every city that produce everything that the city needs, and I think it addresses a lot of social, economic, meaning. You know, autonomy, mastery, purpose, kind of like the deeper pursuit of humanity kind of questions. So I would suggest that. And second, if you're maybe I can ask you, what can you do with the machine right now, the next iteration? Where will you be in terms of imaging? Will you be able to do, like, for example, a baby image, or is that like at that level
system?
Yeah.
Well, we can see if a woman is pregnant or not, definitely. But we will not be able to see the detail on the baby.
Mm-hmm.
But with this, you will be able to see if a woman is pregnant, if there is a big trouble or not. Like a lot of, well, we have a list of 25 pathologies that can be diagnosed by this, by our system.
Where is
like
that? That's on a website?
Or stuff like that.
That's on your website?
Not yet. Well, yes, actually, but it's probably in French. It's on the wiki, actually. We had the, it's on the.
Yeah, because I mean, what I would suggest is, I mean, you know, if you talk to me and say, okay, this is the product we have right now. I'd be interested in collaborating on the production engineering, the open source production engineering. We can maybe create a collaborative working group, or maybe we can join you or start promoting that as another working group that we're involved in. But the idea, so just in short, the idea is we want to collaborate with projects like yours, anyone else who understands or sees or is open to the distributive production model. We teach people to build that, but also we train people that would also run those kinds of production workshops, so that's distribution model is producing and training producers, and I think there's a huge opportunity there. So that's how we're trying to do it, and maybe in the future, like I am considering actually, like once we get the 3D printer, as I mentioned, is going to be the first distributed enterprise that we really push as the concept. Meaning, okay, here's an excellent printer, and here's a way you can build in a single day, where you can have like 50 or 100 people build it in a single day in a large workshop, and it's a construction set, and we're teaching others to do that. We're not afraid to share our business because we just believe in, you know, we just believe in an open source route.
Yeah, it's funny you're saying that, because it's also what we're doing, because to use this device, you should be trained. It's a 2 days training to use the ecostethoscope. So we started the training, but we are training doctors, but we also are training trainers, which is our model,
right?
Because this is exactly what we want to do, because we want to train trainers that will be able to train people all around the world. I mean, if you can train a doctor in a country in Africa, for example, and you will be able to train 5, 10, 15, and so on. So the idea is to spread this idea that with our, like, the ecostethoscopy, affordable, closer, faster, better diagnostic magic tools. Anyway, if you want to spread, that's a good way to spread your idea.
How much attention are you placing on making the parts of the things, like... Because for us, I mean, because we're the Global Village Construction Set, we talk about building the parts that make the set. Like, we're talking about building our own motors and engines as well. Things like our own controller boards and stepper motors. building, starting to build the components. Are you interested in going to that level where you're trying to open source the actual components?
It depends what component you're talking about, because we've, for me, I'm not going to talk in the name of the project, but for me, we have so many technology to hack in the health industry because it's so expensive and it's not accessible to anyone. And anyone should have access to those devices and tools to get a better health or a better healthcare system. So it's more like a matter of, it's a humanity matter, I'd say. And so I think we can hack and open source many, many, many other devices and tools around us. And we are collaborating and discussing with people who are doing like open source IMR, open source scanner, open source tools, open source. They are opening many, many other technology in the healthcare.
Do you know about the open source NMR project?
No, I use open source.
Open source imaging.
NMR, you think?
Yeah. Open source imaging. Yeah.
Oh yes, but yeah. Sorry. Of course, yes. We had a talk together yesterday.
You did what?
Again, because we are planning there is this open source imaging.
That's
open source imaging.
Yeah.
And we have a website.
Yeah, Lucas.
Yeah, exactly. I was on phone with him yesterday.
Oh, good.
On collaborating and doing stuff together. And if you go on the open source imaging website, you will find EchOpen somewhere.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
We have like we talk like every 2 weeks because we are like we're looking at how can we collaborate and also how can we. Have more impact all together, like bringing open source in the healthcare industry, like gathering people with open source project and open source imaging project. So we also have the open bio initiative that is with us, from Italy.
What is
so
that?
We like discussing also again, trying to make this happen together. Yeah, absolutely.
Open biomedical initiative. What's that about, biomedical? What is that, imaging?
It's like more platform gathering. No, it's not dedicated to imaging. It's more like in the biomedical area. It's more like all the projects in the biomedical area. So they're really like, they get large and like low cost open source 3D printables. So it's on their website, openbiomedical.org. And they just going to release a platform to help community work together in a few weeks, I guess.
What's the revenue model? Is that a non-profit? Or
us? Who?
There. Open Biomedical.
Open Biomedical Initiative? Yeah, if I remember well, they are a non-profit organization. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
They are a non-profit organization.
So like maybe, would you be interested in... So as we develop this 3D printer workshop thing, I'm actually considering a world tour doing a bunch of these workshops with collaborating organizations where the intent would be to actually train the collaborating organizations to do it themselves. For example, the Helmut Schmidt University in Hamburg, they have a group there that wants to run these workshops as well. We're collaborating with a PhD student who wants to do an open source a microfactory in Nigeria. But as I do this, maybe we can consider for the future, probably like about a year from now, doing a workshop with you guys, like where we, because you need 3D printing, right? And how do you do your 3D printers right now?
We have a partner access to the 3D printers.
You have a what?
We have access to, sorry?
You have a partner on the 3D printers?
Yeah, we have this AFOP. It's a school. They train in technical skills. They train like 1,600 students. Like, it's not students, it's apprentice. And they have like huge 3D printers, small 3D printers, like all kinds of 3D printers. They're like very into this new model of production. And they give us access to our facilities, and we also have access to all the 3D printers in Fab Labs and Makerspace that we're working with. It's funny because at the beginning of the project, we were thinking of, okay, if one day we can raise funds, the first thing we have to buy is a 3D printer. And finally, we never need it. But we don't really need it. We just have a network around that have very good machines and let us use the machine. So we just pay for the
filament. Filament.
Yeah. And so we have like partnerships, and we exchange a lot of ideas and stuff. And that's very cool for us to have. But of course, that would be cool to consider the idea. I realize that around us we have a lot of people doing like activities like. The people from the low-cost physics, for example, they try to build low-cost equipment for physics laboratory to experiment stuff, and they're in France, and we collaborate a lot together, and especially they work with African countries and South American countries. Like they're doing workshops, like with other people, like how you take a microscope with $40.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yep, can you hear me?
Yeah. It's back.
Yeah. Right. What's the biggest 3D printer that you have access to?
Hold on. I don't hear you anymore.
Can you hear me? No?
It's back.
Okay. I'm asking, what's the largest 3D printer you have access to?
The largest?
3D printer.
What?
Largest 3D printer that you have access to?
Well, it's one that can 3D print stuff in metal. And it's pretty big. I don't know what you mean by largest. Like the size of the object you can build?
Yeah.
Well, that's good. That's a good question. Well, it's probably 40 centimeters.
Yeah.
A little more.
You do have access to any big reps? Big rep, which are like 1 meter?
Not as I know.
Okay. And metal, so metal sintering? Laser metal sintering?
Well, I don't know the name in English. It's just like aggregate.
Yeah.
A little like dust off metal and they build stuff.
Yep.
Well, you see what I mean.
Yeah. Okay, that's interesting. But yeah, maybe we can consider once we get this 3D printer workshop, because we're actually going to Hamburg on April 15 to do this workshop. So maybe we can collaborate in the future if I go on tour, because I want to really talk about this distributed enterprise model and pretty much come up with a collaborative funding platform where we are all contributing products and they're all open source distributive, so that anyone can produce those products and support their efforts through the workshop model. So that's the idea. Because I think the economics work out in that model where you can run a workshop and get a few $1,000s in a single day. If you can pull that off effectively, if it's effective, you know, it takes you only a few days to organize it, then that's a decent revenue model.
Yeah, that's interesting. So, sure. So let us consider this idea first. What I will say is, I have to confirm you on Monday. Jérôme should be here like next Monday to talk to you at, what we said, like 6 my time?
Yeah, 11 a.m.
That's cool. Okay, I'm just going to write down on the agenda. So, I'm going to check out with him probably Monday morning, and I'll let you know, but that should be fine. And I will consider this idea, then we can interact and can like keep getting in touch through email and considering this, and I can see how many people would be interested around us to participate kind of workshop. So this kind of workshop, you think how many people should be a good number? of people, like how many people would be fine?
Are you talking about the actual running of a workshop where people build it?
Yeah, for example, just to have an idea.
I mean, to build a build workshop?
Yeah, for example, just to have an idea.
12 people, minimum.
Oh, okay.
We're going for the Germany thing, we're hoping we get 24 to 50.
Okay, well, that's pretty cool.
Meaning so many of those built in a single day, which is the idea there is if you're doing a lot of that, you can have the production volume of a large corporation, like of a biggest 3D printer company.
Yeah, but that's a very interesting model, and I really like it.
Explore
more, definitely. I'm sorry, but I have to go. I have the next appointment.
Yep. Okay. So thank you. So check
in. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, and we'll see if we can talk on Monday at 11 a.m. Email me.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Well, so 11 a.m. for you, it's 6 p.m. for me.
Yeah.
So we talk at that time, unless I send you a message because there is like a specific problem, but Jean told me that it will be here on Monday, and it should be here on Monday, and he's here at 6 because we have at 7 the weekly meeting, so that's fine.
Okay.
Perfect. Great.
Okay. Thank you, Olivier.
Nice to meet you. Thank you very much.
Take care.
Have a nice day.
Have a nice day. Bye-bye.